could you guys introduce yourselves and say who you are and where you work? You can talk about your beer if you want. And because what we want you guys to do out there watching is to ask questions. So you'll know to whom you're speaking. You can start questions at any time, and we're going to answer them.
Bryce Shafter, I'm the owner of Cinder Brewery here. We're actually having our fourth anniversary next week, so we're having a festival all next week. And we've kind of started here in North Kansas City. Love this area. Love all the people down here as well.
Thanks, Bryce.
My name is Rodney Beagle. I'm the head brewer over at Colony Handcrafted Ales. We're the newest brewery in all of North Kansas City. And we specialize in one-off batches. We try to push the limits on all the stuff that we do down there.
We're gonna come back.
I'm Steve Saroy, owner of Callsign Brewing. Just getting my feet in the ground here in North Kansas City. We're gonna bump Rodney out of the newest brewery, and we hope to be open maybe the first of the year.
Oh, great.
We're gonna specialize in mainly ales.
Joe. I'm Joe Goward. I'm the professional seat filler for Big Rip Brewery's founders and head brewmasters, Josh Collins and Kit Felt. Gonna be here today. I'm also the Wednesday bartender there. We're down at 9th and Swift, and our specialty is a lot of kind of funky beers you can't necessarily get anywhere else. And got the cherry cheesecake on tap right now, so come on down and see us.
Nice. Mr. Glenn.
My name's Glenn Stinson. I'm the owner of Calibration Brewery. We're a gastropub, I guess, to best describe us. We have ciders on tap, as well as a lot of different ales, probably 13, 14 different types of beers on tap right now. We've been in business down here a little over a year, and we're having a celebration October 21st.
Well, and of course, Morgan.
Morgan Perry, Mid-Continent Public Library, small business team. We are here to help you with your business.
All right, so what we're gonna do right now, everybody take a minute, we're gonna share, we're live. We want you to ask us questions. We have a crowded table, which is great because we're gonna have a lot of different viewpoints on being an entrepreneur in beer brewing. That's my voice, it's really crazy. So go ahead, take a minute if you want. And all right, everybody smile. All right, let's get going. It is a crowded table, and it's sort of starting to be a crowded market. Can we talk about what's competition and what's neighborhood? In the brew business, especially up here in this area, what's the difference between, what's it like? Like, tell somebody who doesn't know, what is it like to be a brewer right now in the market? Who wants to take that one?
Sure.
Bryce, you're right here on my right. Yeah. Let's go.
I think right now, I think from us in a Kansas City perspective, North Kansas City perspective, I think all of us have really added more of an attraction and a draw for tourism up here. We saw this similarly in the wine industry, where people would not want to go to just one winery, but to multiple wineries. And I think we're feeling the same effects as we're kind of a growing area here in North Kansas City a lot. So I think the benefit of us having multiple breweries up here has really been more variety to draw people from down south to far north, from Omaha and different areas. So I think it's been a big benefit. I think locality's been key to all of our successes. I think there will be challenges that we've seen over these last, since we've opened in 2013, we've seen the industry change quite a bit, where local has really grabbed a foothold, and the larger breweries have really taken a stronghold on the national footprint. And I think the middle tier is really probably one of the areas that's kind of getting squeezed by both a national brand as well as a locality brand. So I think we will see some industry changes coming throughout these next couple of years, and quality and commitment to what you're doing and letting the public know how much you're committed to making a great product and having a great experience is going to be really important.
So you're talking about location, and that's real estate 101, right? You guys are new. What kind of research and where did you go to find out where you want it to be?
Well, for us, it was pretty simple. This is a very growing community. We've got 4 or 5 breweries right here in town, and I wanted to be part of this tight-knit community here. Some of the research that I've done, it was just looking for the hottest growing area here in the Kansas City area. Mm-hmm. And then talking to a lot of the breweries here in this part here, is the feedback that I was getting, hey, it's growing, we're getting busier, we can't maintain our what we have in our fermenters, so this is a good place to start.
So Morgan, when where should people go if you're looking to go, say, beyond your garage and start and beyond the small festivals and go to brick and mortar? Where should people go to find that information? How do you start that kind of look?
I know I'm a little bit of a broken record, but starting with a Google search, and just as simple as, I want to start a microbrewery. That's an excellent place to start, but really to dig down deep into this, you need to pick the right city to work with. So that means going and having a conversation with them. There's a lot of stuff out there with permitting for alcohol, a lot of different types of permits that you can get, and that's going to hugely affect your business. You need to make sure that your business model works with the city that your business will be in, and that takes conversations.
So Google?
Google.
And conversations.
Conversations with your feet and your face, going there and getting the information.
Rodney, when you guys were starting, what kind of conversations did you have and what came out of those conversations?
Well, at first it was a lot of daydreaming, like, all right, we're going to brew this beer with this name. But when you strip it all down, it starts with lots and lots of paperwork, lots and lots of due diligence, sorry, and just a lot of confidence and a lot of pride in what you're doing. I think that since we're the newest place and it's the most fresh in my mind, I can remember very vividly, we started about a year ago with the paperwork process and everything, and in industry terms, we actually went really fast as far as that go, and I think I credit that to Drew Cobb and Zach Henderson, the owners of Colony, for just having an overwhelming sense of pride and due diligence to tackle the task at hand. When we were first starting off, we had little decisions to make, but we had 1,000 little decisions to make, right? So it, anywhere from the size of the system, you know, how we're going to heat the system, whether it's going to be electric or gas, or we had a lot of different decisions to make. And I think the culmination of so many stuff could get very overwhelming, but if you tackle things one at a time, just one thing at a time until you check it off on your list, then that's the way you be more the most successful, the fastest, I think, with a new startup. The most powerful resource that we have here in North Kansas City as a brewing community is that we have each other, and we've all been through it before. Everybody else besides us had been through it before, so the willingness to share information in this industry is one of the reasons why we decided to open a brewery, is because that in itself is Colony, and it's a community. And so other than Google, definitely use your resources. People are more than willing to share their advice with you.
So we keep coming back to people, the community, and Google. And we had started talking about the paperwork involved, yeah, and how the owners really had to do a lot of work ahead of time. And Glenn, we were just going to, now where you are, how much of you, the day-to-day is paperwork and admin, and how much is getting to do what you dreamed that you would be doing, making beer? What is it, what's a normal day like?
Well, I'm a little different that I didn't come from a brewmaster background. I came from a business background, so I've had other businesses that required a whole lot less paperwork and admin time. Probably out of all the businesses I've had, which is maybe more than a few beers some breweries have, it's required the most amount of time and effort. It's really time consuming.
Did you know that going in, or when did you find that out?
I didn't find out until I partook in the industry.
So we're going to talk about things that you wish you had known ahead of time. Would you have liked to have known ahead of time that it's going to be a little bit more admin, because it's a food and drink industry, right? And does that come usually with more admin, more paperwork than another kind of entrepreneur?
Yeah, we're talking about making a product that people put inside of their bodies. Mm-hmm. And there should be
on a daily basis
more oversight. If I'm going to put it inside of me, we want to make sure that it's safe. We want to make sure that people are following the rules. That comes along with a lot more regulations, a lot more inspections that you wouldn't get if you were breeding friendship bracelets and selling them at a local fair. This is a lot more work, and I think one of the most powerful things Glenn talks about is that at the end of the day, if your heart is not in this business, you're not gonna like this business. Would you do this again, Glenn?
Well, I'm at an age where I can say yay or nay, probably. When you're younger, you're more focused on goals, I think, and stuff like that. This has been a lifelong goal to be involved in a manufacturing process. I want to do that. We decided early in the game to also incorporate a restaurant. And out of the two items, it's required more time on that side of the fence than the brewery side. We have a very experienced brewer that everything is just kind of like, I don't have to worry about anything there. The beers are good. I don't have any quality issues, so I don't have to worry about the paperwork. He has that experience. And but the restaurant's a different side, because you want to reflect what you want and to find the right people to work with you in that area and also give them creative power is very difficult.
These are good questions. Remember, you can write in a question as well. We're happy to have, you can make it specific to somebody, or we can throw it out to the table. You're watching KC Startup 101. Thanks for hanging out with us. We're in the Northland, in Northland, Kansas City, North Kansas City. What we're talking about is the sort of the difference between being a food and beverage company, being a different startup. So if that's something you're interested in, this is the table to ask right here and right now. Joe, talk about what's something you wish you had known before getting into it.
So, and again, I'm speaking on Josh and Kip's behalf.
So we won't hold anything.
That's right. Yes.
Speaking for somebody else.
I got a cheat sheet here. Our brewery is called Big
Rips.
He's
just the face.
No. Just in the many conversations I've had with him, and kind of how Big Rip came to be, and in the style it came to be. It's a series of decisions on what you want to prioritize. And to kind of piggyback off of what Glenn said is that he made the decision early on to be a brewery and a restaurant. And I know for some other breweries out there, they can also take other options. They can kind of do it more modularly. You can have food trucks come in. You could have a third-party business operate out of the same space. We have a place next door that brings food over. So we're entirely just on the beer making portion of it. But there's a lot of different ways to run this and decide how you want to run it. I think, something that they wish they had known early on was, when you get into the industry, how you're kind of pulled largely by your regulars and your the fans of your beer. I think it's kind of expected when you get into beer making that you then go into things like distribution and all that. So then, they can go to another bar and they can get your stuff on tap, or they can go to Quick Trip and get your stuff in a bottle or a can. And when they started out early on, they wanted to make the best tap room that they could and make sure that everything you could get that was Big Rip, you had to go there to get it. And they made some pretty finite boundaries on how they wanted to run everything. It's pretty surprising when you apply that to the business plan, and then you realize what kind of pressure you have to put on each different line of business and how that works out.
You talked about a business plan, Morgan. Where, if you're just getting started and say maybe you know brewing better than the business side of things, where would you tell people to go to get a business plan?
Google.
You can see lots of fun and interesting business plans on Google. I would not go with any of those. And there's two really types of thought around this. And one is hire someone to write it for you, but then you don't know what it means or how it works. And really a business plan, and this is a thinking shift that we need to make. A business plan is a living, breathing document that should grow with your business. You should be able to refer back to it to keep yourself on track. You should be able to make changes to that market analysis as it changes. This should be something that you're constantly updating and working with to keep you on track. And that's what people don't realize. And when you think about it that way, you really need to be involved in the creating of your business plan. So, business plans aren't just for loans.
They're for beer.
They're actually plans for you to use in your business. Because it turns out being strategic is important. There's a lot of people out there that close because they're inflexible. They don't listen. they don't ask for help when they need help, and they're not strategic. So that business plan, it's easy to get help with. We provide help at the library. You can talk to an actual papered librarian, Kelly Head, who can help you with templates, who can help you understand the market analysis. And this comes back to that whole gut versus brain. We love our guts. They tell us good things. We put the beer in and they're like, this tastes good, but why does it taste good? Your business should involve those same questions. I think this is a great idea. Why do I think this is a great idea? Can I prove it? It's all a risk. Make the safer bet. And a good way to do that is to get help with your business plan. And I'm gonna throw something out there. Taking a class like Kaufman Fast Track can really give you a basis. It can be a catch-up to get you in this mindset of running a business. Because Glenn was exactly right. You gotta have somebody that understands business involved in your business. It's awesome to be good at making a thing. That is great. But if you want to take being good at making a thing and giving it to your friends in your basement and making it a business, we want you to be successful. So use those resources to learn about the business part. My heart is broken weekly by things I can't get anymore out on the market because that person was so awesome at making that thing, but not so awesome at running a business.
It is both. And so, maybe it's the business plan, maybe it's the location, but we actually have a question in from Ian. Ian, thank you for your, it's a three-parter. I'm gonna pull out one and then maybe we get to more of them. I'm gonna send this one over to Steve, and it says, from Ian, what's the biggest obstacle that you've had to overcome? Is it anything that we've talked about, or is it something?
No, the biggest obstacle that we overcame, and so far so good, financing. We talk about business plan. I went with a professional that I'm stationed with, Owen Compton. He did my business plan, and we custom tailored it to the brewing community. From there, we launched a Kickstarter. We were hoping for 20. We managed to make 25,000.
Nice.
The business plan was actually really good. They talk about going to a bank and trying to get a business loan, which is next to impossible. I got lucky. My first time to apply for a business loan, I was financed. So therefore, I don't really need to go through investors, which is good. So I think that the finance part is probably the hardest part.
Finance part is the hardest part. So Ian, financing, so find a buddy who can help you.
Yes.
Go to the library. Business plan, back to that. Ian's also wondering, and this one, Bryce, I'm gonna throw to you, do you wish there were any specific laws that would be changed in relation to owning this type of business? Or what, it's an obstacle question in a
gotcha.
Way.
The state of Missouri probably sets a lot of the precedents for our laws. I mean, we've got federal laws that are pretty good. The state's been great. Probably if I would say one thing, so we make cider as well, and oddly enough, the federal laws surrounding cider are a little bit more stringent than the federal laws surrounding beer, because cider falls in the wine category. So with beer, we have a luxury of aging in a variety of barrels and adding a lot of different spices and characters. Cider, on the other hand, if I were to carbonate the beer above cider above three volumes, all of a sudden it classifies itself as a champagne. And so my tax goes from, cents to $3 a gallon. So there's a lot of interesting things that surround cider comparative to beer. Also, I can't add as many fruits as I want to the beer, right? So if I want to make a fruited beer of some sorts, which is really popular right now, I can add those fruits. Cider, as soon as I add anything outside of cherry, it reclassifies itself as a different tax bracket. So I think that's something which from a federal level would change, because it's somewhere, it's kind of lost in the center of wine and beer. And so I wish that would change a little bit.
Ian, that was a super specific but great question and a great answer from Bryce. Well, I just learned a whole lot about fruits and how to tax them.
Yeah.
This is the third part of yours, and it's a bit of a softball. We're going to run you over here. How does the passion come through in the brewer's beers? And break that up between how do you still keep making a good beer, the beer that you care about, the love at the end of the day, and run a business? I'm just going to add to your question, Ian.
Sure. Every single brew is a direct reflection of the passion of not only the brewer of the beer, but also the collective, just everybody that's involved with running that business. We tend to have like-minded goals and like-minded end results in mind. So when we go out to design a beer or to plan a beer out in the beginning stages, the passion is what is the first thing that drives everything. With what was the second part of that question?
Well, then how, when you're starting to do the business of, how do you keep that passion going?
I would be lying if I didn't say the business part of it put a damper on it a little bit, because it does.
You shouldn't lie. I think that's exactly right. Like, does everybody feel that?
You go from this homebrewer mindset to where the world is your oyster, and then you go to brick and mortar, and then everything kind of slows down a little bit as far as that goes. Your goal is to have creativity be paramount in everything that you do, but at the same time you have that monkey on your back, which is business, right? Mm-hmm. So you have to conform, and you have to think from that side of the spectrum as well. And in that, I think that your team that you work with is key to that, because like in my situation, I'm the creative juice that starts the beer making process, but then I gather ideas from all different directions. Drew is our paperwork guy, so he does all the paperwork. He takes on that brunt to achieve that part of it. Zach is the operations guy, the other owner of Colony, and we all kind of just blend really perfectly, and it's really, really key to have a good team surrounding.
You called it a monkey on your back. Mm-hmm. Morgan, when somebody's maybe mid-business, not a brand new, but still in the startup phase, where can somebody go to help with that monkey? Is it you guys talking about going to events? Is it going to networking events? Where, when you get rolling, should one go?
There's lots of opportunities for startups to get help with those basic startup questions. The problem comes what happens when you come out of that 3-year phase and you're established, but are you growing? How much do you want to grow? Do you know if you need to grow? Sometimes it's harder not to grow than it is to let the growth happen. And how do you control that growth? That's when a business coach comes in really handy. Someone that you can
talk to, hopefully.
Someone you can talk to about these things and help you work through them, because it might be an issue with, I have my loyal supporters and they keep me operating week to week to week, but what happens if I need new customers? What are the new things? Or what happens if I'm going to add food to this? Because I feel like I'm losing people after 90 minutes of drinking, because then they leave to go get food. But I know I could keep them for 3 hours of drinking, for better or worse results, if I added food to this business equation. And having someone you can talk to with things like that. So really good resources, UMKC Small Business Technology Development Center. They have a lot of the Kauffman programming that comes out of there. Kansas City is one of only 7 cities in the nation that has a free program called Scale Up. Scale Up is designed to get you to your first $1 million. So it really is intended for businesses that are established and ready to grow. They do 2 or 3 cohorts of Scale Up every year. You cannot beat that program. No one else is offering anything like that. All you have to do is apply for it, and you get access to the experts in how to grow your business. So there are less opportunities for help if you're transitioning from startup into established, but it's still there. They're gonna ask you for more buy-in though. You're gonna have to fill out an application. You're gonna have to set up meetings. Whereas in the startup community, you can kind of show up for a thing, and then you can go kind of show up for a different thing. It's really fast and loose.
But once you get going, you need to dig in a little bit.
Yes, that's absolutely right.
Make the investment in growing or in stabilizing.
Right, it's a different game when you're coming out of the startup phase. It's a much different game. You've got people working for you at this point. way more than you did when you started up. You've built those relationships, so just on a personal level of the people counting on you, the stress is much higher. And I know everybody in the startup phase freaks out and they're like, this is the most stress ever. Yeah, but imagine that with 25 people depending on you for their livelihood. That's even more stress.
Yeah, I'd have to hit on that. So we're at a stage where we've been open 4 years and we started distributing beer roughly 2 years ago and really have gained momentum in this last year and a half. And so for me, it's kind of a, I think of it as velocity, right?
Mm-hmm.
What is the speed, the pace, the velocity, and the direction you're heading? And I think there's a lot of any business, once they feel like they've got a sliver of success, that they want to accelerate toward that success. And I think with our industry, from my perspective, it has to be very carefully plotted out, just because the market becomes more saturated with individuals going into it, not just locally, but national brands and regional brands coming in. I think making sure you're ready to supplement not just making a product, but marketing, a sales force, all of those dollars add to the bottom line of actually getting your product and recognition for your product. So I think being at your own pace is really important in this industry at this point in time.
Mm-hmm. Bryce, that's so true. We did food truck startup, and that was exactly because you have to be careful when you're working with a perishable product. You can't go up too fast. You can't, it's a real issue.
And
again, eats and drinks have that very specific problem or issue.
If Bryce creates 25 pallets of canned beer, there is a time limit on that beer from when it should hit that customer's mouth in their home or at the game. So he has to make sure that he is selling enough beer off the shelves, shelves he doesn't touch, shelves he probably doesn't see. He has to make sure that that product is moving and that he's creating the right amount of product at the right time so that it doesn't expire before it ever gets to the store.
So there are different challenges. Hey, you guys, thanks for joining KC Startup 101. I know the connectivity has been going back and forth, but I hope that you're hearing. We've got some really great conversation going here. We're going to start to talk about our takeaways. We've got about 10, 15 minutes left. We're going to go around and talk about the one thing either you wish that you had known or the one piece of advice you'd like to give or that you wish you'd gotten. Takeaways are pretty wide open field. Glenn, let's start with you. What's your takeaway that you would offer to somebody who's interested out there watching?
Well, be prepared to spend a lot of energy, for one. And as everyone said around the table, you have to have passion for this. If you don't have the passion, you won't have the energy. And also to be realistic in knowing that, as Bryce and everyone here can agree with, when you're trying to grow your business, it's a fine line there because there's a huge investment in this industry with sometimes very little return, and it's a long process. So be encouraged by your own energy.
Passion fuels energy, and that energy will hopefully get you through the monkeys that are going to be crawling up. Joe, what would be your takeaway for any point?
Yeah, I think know what business you're getting into, because you may say, hey, I want to go out there, I want to start brewing beer, but what does that mean? What's the end game there? I know that a lot of energy goes into kind of creating the taproom experience for us at Big Rib, because that's a big priority for us. So, you know, right down to the theming of all the beers after being sci-fi and horror, we've got, you know, goofy B movies on Netflix on, and people go in there, they know what kind of experience they're gonna get, you know, at least for our regulars. But none of them would be coming back if our beers weren't good. We're in the beer making business, and so having the passion to make unique beers that maybe it's walking that line between experimenting but then also being very quality, to make sure people keep coming back. And I think it's knowing what is the utmost importance for that entire business that you're starting, and just focusing everything around that and just being the absolute best you can there.
So Joe, what I'm hearing from you is prioritize, and that's the word that you used, is figure out what it is that you want to be and do that? And that goes back to the business plan model. Was there a business plan? Was that all included in the business plan?
Absolutely, yeah. For Josh and Kip, you know, they run the place like they did right from the get-go, which was to make the most incredible tap room. And, you know, I think you get into certain industries and you're kind of stretched in certain directions and like, well, okay, you get in here, the logical end game is this, and so you need to start doing this. And you probably get a lot of people surrounding you saying, hey, you need to start doing this, you need to start doing this, you need to be the next whoever. And I think it's really important to realize, like, okay, well, we've got our product, we've got our idea, and we've got our business. We put in, you know, X amount of investment, and this is what we get out of it. And being able to kind of lasso that and get your arms around it and know what you're doing and what your commitment is to it is really, really huge. Just making your own personal mark on it.
So the focus in, again, the passion, we're hearing that. Steve, what's your takeaway? What would you offer up?
Well, my takeaway on this is expect things to take a whole lot longer than you expect. You know, if you're trying to do your plumbing work and you allotted yourself 8 days to do it, you might as well just triple that because nothing goes right. The first 3 days, you're going to have other people just showing up to your location, saying, hey, how's it going? What are you doing? Where are you at now? And then, you know, by the time you know it, you've spent an hour and a half with that person, and then well, half the day is gone. So definitely allot yourself more time than expected. But passion, you got to have the passion. Just like everybody's going to say, I think everybody's going to touch in on that. If you don't have the passion, you're not going to make a good beer. All right, so everybody's got a reason to make beer. Keep that passion, and there'll be days where you're looking at your brewery and it's like, my God, what did I do? And then you get a message saying, hey, Steve, I love what you're doing. You guys are going to rock. I can't wait till you open. Just press on.
But it sounds like there's some very realistic advice coming out from the side. Things are going to take longer. It's going to be a little bit harder, so you got to keep that focus, keep that passion.
Yeah.
Or Emma's,
well,
go ahead.
Another thing is surround yourself with positive people. You know, and this is not more of a competitive type of business. I've gotten a lot of help from a lot of the breweries here in this area. I wouldn't be where I'm at if it wasn't for them. Whether it's just a simple question like, hey, how did you accomplish this? Or your paperwork, what's it look like? Could you look this over? And when you have the positive people that are in the business as well saying, hey, you know, change this up, this looks good, get rid of that, how are you doing? It makes even the harder times a whole lot better because they're like, just keep pressing forward and you're gonna make it happen.
So also don't live in a vacuum. You
don't.
Need to go out and you need to interact.
Yes.
And this industry especially is conducive for that, especially in this town. I mean, it's a Kansas City thing for local people to support each other, and just especially in this industry too. You know, you've got a great brewing community here that has each other's backs. So yeah, get out there and talk to other brewers, go visit their places, drink their beer, support them.
And they'll support you.
Yeah, they'll support
in return.
You, yeah, exactly.
That's good. Rodney, what about you? What would be the takeaway that you'd offer up to the audience?
I'm like speaking some cliches because when I was researching how to do this and getting a whole bunch of advice from people that have done this before, they said, going back to what Steve said, it's going to take twice as long and three times the amount of money that you think it's going to take. And with everybody that I've kind of started to venture with, they have said that, oh no, well that won't be us. You know, we're going to rise above that and you know, we're going to take steps to where that doesn't happen. Guess what? It happens. And that's probably one of the most powerful cliches. And that's something that keeps repeating itself. And you think that you're above that, but you're not. So
expect
twice as much time and three times the amount of money as you thought. I always say that if you brew it, they will come, right? But if you brew it well, they'll come back. And I'm not just talking about the beer. I'm talking about the experience. It's a trickle-down effect that comes all the way from the owner to the dishwasher, if you have one. Just everybody. One of the best examples I have is one of the first times I ever went to Colorado and I went to a brewery there. I looked around and it was overstaffed. There was 10 people in a little tap room working at one time. But every single one of those person, those employees, when I looked around, had a big smile on their face because they loved what they do, and it permeates throughout the entirety of the business itself. So if you provide the building blocks of atmosphere and friendliness and awesome beer, then great things are going to come. The last word of advice, and this is just kind of the way we decided to do it, is to grow organically. Don't be forced into growth that you're uncomfortable with. Rather, grow at your own pace. And you said earlier, it's harder yeah. to do that. It's harder to put those restraints on. I've seen it when I was working for Big Rip. It took 8 months for them to double their system size, right? And that was their decision. But since then, there's not been a lot of growth, and that's controlled, and I look up to that a lot. So me moving forward, only being open 2.5 weeks, my beer's almost gone already, and I'm having to build up a stockpile. So I am going to have to grow, but when that happens, it's going to be on our terms, not on the public's term, to keep it comfortable for us.
When can I get a coffee culture again, by the way? I've gone in there twice now.
Yeah.
Denied.
That's going to be brewed next week.
Good. Okay.
You said it'll take 3 times as much money, twice as long. Mm-hmm. We're hearing that. Mm-hmm. Bryce, what's your takeaway? Does it go with that theme, or do you have something else that you would offer up?
So I think having a great idea is just the first step in it. When I always think about what we do here, people, process, passion, and beer. And I think the key thing is people, right? So you can have a great idea as yourself, you'll never succeed. The people that you surround yourself with people that are better at things than you are, give them opportunities to grow and achieve, and everyone will grow and be successful together. And that's the only way we stand where we are today, because the people that surround me are far better at things that I could ever have done on my own. And I've just provided the opportunity for them to grow the business in ways that I never really thought it could be. They bring ideas, they bring creativity, and they bring assets that really the people that are part of what we do here are my most important asset, even more than money, financing, whatever it is, because no matter if we lack the financing to go do something or we lack the time to go do something, when we come together, we're gonna figure out how to accomplish the things we all wanna go do together.
That sounds a little bit like networking. Morgan, take us home. Let's put all of these together. It's going to take longer. It's going to be a little bit harder. You're going to spend a little bit more time on paperwork than you ever thought.
You are running a business that happens to deal in beer. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, that can be heartbreaking for you, or that can be gaining new skills for you, or finding people that really flesh out what you're not so great at, and working as a team. And that's something that we've heard repeatedly around the table today. Community, 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 my team, the people who work with me. I've got a brewer that I feel perfectly safe with. I trust this guy. He has got it. You have heard that repeatedly because it is important, because a lot of people would say that is necessary. You are not an island. You are going to have to ask for help, and you're going to have those team members in place that can help you, because we're not all perfect at everything. We're just not. So if you establish who you are as a business, if you establish that brand, and then you get the team members on board that understand that vision, that live and breathe that brand, then you're going to have 50% of the battle taken care of. Because this is going to be battle after battle after battle and one giant war. That's going to take as long as you have this business open, because you have to grow, right? You have to continue to change. You have to have a plan. You have to execute the plan. All of these things are too much for one person. So take what these guys are saying to heart. They are exactly right. And we hear this every single time we do this program. Get the right people, figure out who you are, make a plan, execute the plan. We tend to think that when we have hard things to deal with, it'd just be best if we not bother other people with them, right? We're gonna John Wayne up, we're gonna tie our boot a little tighter, and we're just gonna muscle through it. Those businesses fail repeatedly. So take these lessons.
which I, what we're also hearing around the table is it's about passion. And that's true with every startup. So whatever business you're in, mm-hmm. the passion has got to keep coming through to the top. We have a lot of passion for you guys. Thank you so much for watching KC Startup 101. In 2 weeks, we'll be back in the at Kansas City PBS in the Midtown under the Great Red Tower. We'll be talking about breast cancer. It's Breast Cancer Awareness Month. We'll have another round table. To get all your beer news, don't forget flatlandkc.org. We have tap list every Tuesday, hashtag tap list. And this is hashtag KC Startup 101. Thanks you guys for joining us. We'll see you in 2 weeks. And clearly, I think I'm the amateur at this table. thanks to you gentlemen. Thank you, Morgan. We'll see you in 2 weeks.